your case is a unique one because you are already a rather well-known figure in the field of transpersonal psychology before you began to enter into a process of recovery from alcoholism.
This is true. And it was very humiliating for that very reason. I thought of myself as a transpersonal person. I thought of myself as a spiritual person. I've been drawn to spirituality ever since I was a child. When mm-hmm. I became an alcoholic, I had a spiritual teacher. I was meditating. I was identified as this devotee, as someone on the path. Mm-hmm. And that actually became part of my denial system. Mm-hmm. You know, how could I be a lowly alcoholic? How could I have a problem with this sort of mundane stuff because I was such a spiritual person? But I was a very unfortunate alcoholic and mm-hmm. had to go through the process of coming to terms with that, of hitting bottom, of realizing that I wasn't all that different from anyone else mm-hmm. Who had my same problem. Mm-hmm. And in that place, from that place of humility, to begin to live my life in a much more honest way. Mm-hmm. What happened was, in the process of hitting bottom, I did have a profound spiritual experience, not in a church or a synagogue, but in a treatment center. And it was what I had been looking for a very long time. And so it began to show me immediately that there was this deep connection between the spirituality that I had always sought mm-hmm. out and also this yearning inside of me that I had mistakenly filled with alcohol.
Mm-hmm. Well, I suppose your case is unique in that there had been so much preparation in terms of the spiritual work you had been doing. And then you were able to sort of use the process of recovery from alcoholism in combination with that background mm-hmm. to come to a point where now you're the author of a book about it.
Well, it was both a help and an obstacle because yes. I had to really become ordinary. And, you know, I had spent a lot of time in kind of non-ordinary worlds and mm-hmm. being interested in the spirit. And I had to get right back down to ground zero yeah. and then... What was very surprising is that in the recovery community, there were spiritually based recovery programs, and I became familiar with, for example, the 12-step programs, and I began to realize that something like the 12 steps contains within it the same wisdom as other spiritual traditions that I'd been attracted to. It was in much more ordinary, kind of grounded language mm-hmm. than a lot of the traditions I'd been interested in. And there was this large community of people who had been doing the work, who knew how to guide me, that I could ask questions and ask for support. And it was like coming home.
Mm-hmm. In other words, if we look at Alcoholics Anonymous and other 12-step programs, which are the major programs mm-hmm. in Western culture that are treating these problems, the cure for alcoholism is a spiritual path.
I think so. I mean, there's the reality that people can't improve the quality of their life unless they stop doing their addiction. Mm-hmm. So first of all, take care of the physical problem, stop the addiction, work in a very down-to-earth way with doing that. And mm-hmm. then once that's kind of established, begin to work mm-hmm. on I see addiction as a mosaic yeah. that there's the physical, the emotional, mental, social, and also the spiritual, and I think they all need to be addressed in order for successful recovery mm-hmm. So some people will get into their recovery in about 4 or 5 years, they will begin to discover some underlying issues, emotional yeah. issues or family mm-hmm. issues or abuse issues that they hadn't allowed themselves to feel because yeah. of the buffer of their addiction. Mm-hmm. So those need to be tended to.
Yeah.
But then there is also the spiritual. And yeah. I believe so strongly that unless the spiritual aspect of addiction and addiction recovery is addressed, mm-hmm. that the quality of recovery mm-hmm. is really limited.
Well, I suppose it's very risky when there are so many unique individuals out there struggling with these issues to suggest that one model should fit all.
Right.
And it's very presumptuous for me or for you or anyone to tell somebody who's going through the agonies of recovery that, oh, this is a spiritual path you're on.
Right, right. Uh-huh. Exactly. They'll say, what do you mean spiritual? This doesn't feel spiritual. You mm-hmm. know, I'm craving my drug or I'm... that's where the wisdom of the community comes in, you know, to be able to talk regularly and listen regularly to people who have had the experience, who are maybe further down the road than mm-hmm. than we are, and to learn from them.
Yeah.
And then just keep putting one foot in front of the other. Mm-hmm. I like what the 12-step programs say about one day at a time.
Yes.
You know, let's just deal with this present moment as best we can, mm-hmm. and then we'll see what mm-hmm. tomorrow brings.
Well, one of the key aspects of the 12-step program, as I understand it, is the idea of surrendering to a higher power, the understanding that at the level of the ego, we're out of control.
Absolutely.
We don't have power over our addiction. Our addiction has power over us. And if we're going to gain mastery of our own lives, we have to call upon something larger than what we normally think of ourselves to be.
Absolutely. And in this way, it's really not different from many other mm-hmm. Spiritual traditions, which require some kind of surrender mm-hmm. of the ego. There's a lot of confusion, I think,
yeah.
with that particular step of how do I let go? Yeah. You know, I remember hearing a man saying, you know, for the last 40 years, I've been taught in my society that as a man, I should be powerful. And now you're asking me to become powerless,
mm-hmm.
you know, or people who have had a history of abuse or oppression in some way, who have struggled to kind of gain some sort of power, and someone they will say, I mean, you're asking me to give up the power that I've worked so hard mm-hmm. to achieve. The irony is that by stepping aside as an ego, that there's a deeper mm-hmm. power that's mm-hmm. just right there waiting, and it's that power that people are then able to mm-hmm. tap and use in their healing and recovery.
And I suppose one of the other ironies of all of this is that many people find under the influence of alcohol or other drugs that it brings them closer to a kind of, I think you use the term pseudo-mystical
yes.
experience. They believe that it gets them in touch with their larger self. They believe that they find God in the bottle somehow.
Well, this is what William James recognized to be true, what Bill Wilson, the co-founder of Alcoholics Anonymous, wrote about, this kind of pseudo-mystical experience. That what Bill Wilson said is that addicts and alcoholics are seekers. They want to know about the mysteries of God and life, but they make the mistake of looking in the wrong places. And that I hear it all the time from people in recovery. You know, when I first took my first drink, when I took my first drug, when I had my first sexual high, you know, when I felt that first rush of power, that was my first spiritual experience. And mm-hmm. then I spent the next 10 or 20 or 30 or 40, 50 years trying to recapture that.
Yeah.
And instead was spun further and further mm-hmm. out of control into addiction. Mm-hmm.